the major highlights of this bill?
You see, before I, Kriti, go into that, I would like to say that in the medical profession in India, we have a council for doctors and for dentists and a council for nurses and for pharmacists. Now, these councils set standards and they ensure the quality of education, with the result that our doctors and nurses are supposed to be the best in the world. They do very well in the entire world. On the other hand, apart from these four categories, there are many other professionals in the field of medical care, like, for instance, physiotherapists, optometrists, lab technicians, x-ray technicians. We have identified 53 of them so far, which are divided broadly into 15 categories. They also need to have standards set for them, and they also have to ensure quality. There's no provision at the moment to do this, and therefore we have come up with this bill, which has been approved by the cabinet. Under this bill, what we'll have is a council at the center, and there'll be corresponding councils in every state. These councils, because they cater to about 53 categories of people, 53 kinds of professions, therefore there'll be professional advisory boards in each council at the central level and the state level also, who will advise the council on matters related to that particular group of individuals they are dealing with. Because the number of colleges where education is being imparted is very large, and because the number of people involved is also very large, therefore the major action would be at the level of the states. The central council would set policies and standards, and they would be enforced and ensured by the state councils. So state councils, they will have the major role, and the central council will not have so much of a major role. They'll be more in the nature of a coordinator or policy setter or a standard setter.
Right. Sir, I just wanted to ask you that currently these healthcare, allied healthcare professionals are largely unregulated, unidentified, and even underutilized. So in that context, how important is this bill, and does it come at an opportune time?
Priti, I think there could not have been a better time for finally sort of having, gotten all of these professionals, getting them the right platform for professional recognition, and really for getting them to sort of be the best at their profession, which is really, you know, what the work of any regulator should be, is to try to create the professionals. Once they start doing their best, and once we have standards in place for doing that, I think then we create what we call a multidisciplinary care team, not just doctors or not just nurses, but everybody who touches a patient or interacts with a patient is operating to some set standards, to certain standard operating procedures and protocols. And that's been the norm in, you know, if you look at pretty much around the world, that's the way that happens. So I think this bill is extremely critical, because I think in addition to setting those much needed standards, it's in a way telling these people, y'all are important to us. You know, it is not just about doctors, not just about nurses, pharmacists, those that have been in the system, but everybody comes together, and it is really a team approach to care, which is there's enough evidence to say that that's the best way in which care is delivered. So this is a very critical time for the bill.
Mr. Singhal, a WHO report has pointed out that by the year 2030, globally we'll need 15 million allied healthcare professionals. Tell us about the employment generation potential of this proposed legislation.
Kriti, you already have the figures. WHO says there will be 1.5 crore or 15 million people required by 2030. And given the demographic dividend of India, I think we have the potential to supply professionals to the entire world. So that is the foreign employment aspect. And within the country also, what is going to happen is, as the quality of paramedical and allied health workers is ensured, doctors would be able to place a lot of reliance on them. Today, the quality is uncertain, and the curriculum is also uncertain. The minimum standards are not being ensured in colleges where they're being taught. So the quality may be suspect in some cases. As a result, doctors are not able to repose faith in them. The day you have very highly qualified and good professionals available, then doctors would be able to see more patients, because they would have competent help from the allied health workers. And therefore, the requirement and the wages which are paid to these professionals would improve, and employment opportunities within the country also would improve very significantly.
So what is the kind of impact that you're seeing in terms of numbers, in terms of figure?
You have mentioned a figure of 9 lakh professionals in the country. I don't really know, because there's no database of all these professionals right now. It's very difficult to say. Every association says we have so many lakh people with us. Until we actually do some kind of enrollment and look at the manpower which is already there, we don't really have the correct figures. But I can very confidently say that if the entire world is going to need 15 million, then we also would be needing a similar number in India, because the population is huge, challenges are huge in India. So a similar figure can be thought of for India also.
Right, point well taken. Mr. Narayan, now that we're talking about quality, and quality of education. How can this proposed legislation ensure that allied healthcare workers or professionals are qualified to do so and bring about standardization of education?
So, Kriti, the formula, if you will, you know, for sort of how any standard setter works is the same, which is first a set of experts come together and we have to all agree on what is an acceptable standard in terms of education, in terms of practice, in terms of educational institutions that are running these courses. So, for example, you know, when we know with the medical council, for example, there are standards on, you know, what constitutes a good medical college. Similarly, we also need those same kind of standards of equipment, standards of duration of the courses, you know, what are people taught, what are the modules that are taught, and most importantly, what are the skills and competencies that the professionals come out with at the end of the course. So those are some of the main criteria that are standardized. So once these get set up, I mean, that means these get defined, which the professional advisory boards, as Mr. Singhal was referring to earlier, we envision that they will set these standards and say, this is what a good physiotherapist looks like. This is what a good physiotherapy college would do in terms of, you know, getting these professionals out. Once those standards are set, it is then up to the work of the council and through the state councils to ensure that the norm is met. So, you know, whether when it comes to either inspection or calling it a check, you know, coming back and accrediting. So accreditation, inspection, etc., are mechanisms to ensure that the standards that are set are in place. And finally, that results in a license for the professional that comes out that says, yes, you have met these standards. You have, you know, you have both these skills and competencies as well as the knowledge. So there's an educational component and a skill and a competence component. Altogether, if we can check you off as saying you have it, then, you know, you come out and we have validated both the institutions providing the education, also the individuals coming out of it. And that's the most simplistic way of explaining how this would work.
Well, that's an important point. So, Mr. Singhal, how would this ensure standardization of education, say, entry into institutions or exit out of the institutions? How would that be decided?
You see, as Kavita ji has pointed out, there would be standard curricula and therefore the quality of education will be ensured after having minimum standards. But the bill also talks of an entry exam, common entry exam,
right,
and a common exit exam. If you are able to have that at some point of time in future, then the people entering a college would be of assured quality and the their knowledge level would be tested when they pass out also. But that of course will come later, not in the immediate future. Because first of all, we have to look at the people who are actually practicing in the field at the moment. We'll be enrolling all of them, trying to find out what kind of education they have received already. For instance, for ophthalmic assistants, there are courses of 2 years duration today, there are courses of 4 years duration today. If you go to a shop where spectacles are being made, you may find an optometrist who has done a proper course of 3 years, or you may find somebody who has just done a 3 months course somewhere and then he's sitting there and practicing as an optometrist. So until we enroll all the people who are there and see whom we can take onto our register, who can be registered and who cannot be registered, what kind of skills have to be imparted to the people who cannot be registered to make them register. So 9 lakhs is a very significant number. We have to look at these people first of all and assure that they also will be part of the ecosystem later on. We can't really wish them away. So we have to look at all that, and once we do all that, regularize the people who are already there in the field, then we can think of recognizing colleges, recognizing courses, and thinking of an entry exam. So I think an entry exam and exit exam would come much later, not in the immediate future. There will be an interim council for 2 years, and when the interim council is finally succeeded by a final proper council, at that stage perhaps they will start thinking of an exit exam and an entry exam.
Ma'am, what would be the impact of this proposed legislation on the skill set of our professionals?
I think this would finally, again, I think it would be sort of the gold seal, you know. So I think we know that there are set of professionals that are already skilled. There is already a mechanism that exists for, you know, sort of also the skill ministry as well as the skill development ecosystem, which is there, has already given it some sort of, you know, shape to it. And those what we consider are the skilled workers are those that we are at least in the bill defining as those that have training for under 2,000 hours or roughly about 2 years. The reason we are saying that is because, you know, you also want to give them a career pathway. So you could be a skilled worker tomorrow who should have the potential to rise up and, you know, maybe become an allied health worker, allied health professional, and then, you know, hopefully healthcare professional, etc. And it's purely dependent upon the number of, you know, how much they are studying, how much education and skill component there are. For the skill part itself, I think the fact that this would actually ensure that there is a validation to the fact that there is a skill certification. So far it has been, you know, I think health has also been put along with everybody. You know, health is very, very specific, right? It's more than just skilling in let's say, you know, for food processing or more than for any other, for beauty salon, etc. This is very specific. There are a very set of specific standards that would impact patient care, most importantly. So this would therefore then, I think, allow it to be on a specialized path as it must be for healthcare. So this, I think, actually really gives the skill ecosystem a big boost as well.
All right. Mr. Singhal, talking about the cost component now. The total cost implication as of now is expected to be around 95 crore in the next 4 years. How much would be earmarked between the center and the states respectively?
Kriti, the cost involved is very small, and these councils would all be self-sustaining after a certain period of time. We have the example of Medical Council of India, Dental Council of India. They're all self-sustaining because they register individuals, they charge some money for that. They recognize colleges, they charge money for that. So we expect that within 5 years, all the support from the budget would peter out, and all the councils in the states as well as the center would be self-supporting. So the cost is a very small component. It is not really a major issue. 95 crores is indicative. It may go up slightly or come down slightly. It's not really much of an issue.
Right. On that note, I'll slip into a short break. Time for a short break. On the other side, we'll have lots more. Stay tuned. Welcome back. You're watching Policy Watch, and the discussion on the Allied and Healthcare Professions Bill 2018 continues. Mr. Singhal, tell us more about the role and the functions of the central as well as the state councils.
You see, the central council would basically be into policy making, setting standards which can be enforced then by the state councils. But all the action actually would be at the level of the states, because the number of colleges imparting education is huge. The number of professionals involved is huge. The central council cannot on its own, unlike bodies like MCI and Dental Council, where the number of colleges is very limited. The central council cannot actually recognize every college which is imparting education. So all the action would, I would say, lie at the level of the states, and the policy making and the standard setting would be done at the central level.
Ms. Narayan, how important is this proposed legislation for realizing the targets of Ayushman Bharat for providing accessible health care?
Kritiji, I think this goes really closely in tandem with, you know, sort of the overall goal of Ayushman Bharat, purely because, you know, if you look at the health system, you know, from a public health expert standpoint, we talk of the various levers of the health system. You know, there's infrastructure, there's technology. The people lever, in my mind, is one of the most critical, you know, and that's been the sort of the bane of our of health systems globally. I mean, when you don't realize it. So today, you know, when you have sort of standards at place for all of the professionals, and like I was saying, the fact that, you know, the doctor sort of leads the pack, you know, is sort of, as you, I've envisioned the doctor to be sort of the CEO, you know, sort of doing the, you know, making sure that the right treatment is happening, the diagnosis is happening, and doing the thinking for ensuring that the care is given. But today in our country, we do not have adequately trained support, as well as, you know, good people who can independently, as well as under direction, support the doctor to enable him or her to be fully efficient. And that's where, you know, when we have the challenge of providing universal healthcare or Ayushman Bharat, what Ayushman Bharat proposes, yes, and envisions to 1.3 plus billion people, without having that sort of, you know, arms and legs and the team that can go out and execute, some, you know, under direction, some independently for some of the care. There is evidence that says that 70% of, for example, the care, you know, that's already 70% of the problems that people come in for primary care are all things that can be done, you know, with just doctor supervision. It doesn't have to, you don't have to go in. We don't need the doctor, for example. The radiology is a simple example. You don't need a radiologist to be, you know, going and doing, for example, the ultrasound, which takes about 30 to 40 minutes for a pregnant woman. If you had excellent ultrasound trained technologists, you know, in the system, which many other countries have, this would save the doctor's time to read 200, 300 radiology reports. And, you know, we have a big radiology shortage in this country, and that's only one specialty. Similarly, you have these groups of professionals who can actually really help sort of task shift downwards. And really that's where, you know, the biggest help will come. So when you can give some of the tasks away to some of the people to say, do this, then the doctor becomes more efficient. And as we allow the reach of the doctor to go much further, both in rural and urban India, in terms of the doctor's knowledge and expertise, I think that'll happen when he or she has a good sort of support, not just with nurses and pharmacists, but this whole other group that we have sort of not realized their potential of. And that's how I really think we will enable the vision of Ayushman Bharat to be
So the entire chain you're talking about.
Yes,
it's Mr. Singhal, I'd also like to take your opinion on this, that how would the proposed law corroborate the Ayushman Bharat program?
It's very, you see, Ayushman Bharat has two pillars. One pillar is about primary and promotive health care, that is through the health and wellness centers. The other is about tertiary care, which is through PMJ. There are two components to Ayushman Bharat. Now, at both levels, properly trained allied health workers are very, very important. What we look at is that with some training, properly trained health workers could take over the role of primary and preventive and promotive health care at the health and wellness center level after some certification. And in the hospital environment for tertiary care, they can discharge a much greater role than what they are doing today. under the direct supervision of a medical officer. And in that case, the productivity of doctors would improve. So for both pillars of Ayushman Bharat, properly trained allied health workers are a must. They are a very essential requirement, and this bill would go a long way in fulfilling that.
And what are the penalties to check the malpractices in the bill?
The penalties are monetary penalties, and as we have in the Medical Council Bill, there's some imprisonment also. But we don't really have to dwell upon that at the moment. That is not the important part. The important part is improving the quality of education, improving the quality of manpower. The penalties come later, and the penalties are not the main objective of the bill. It's more to improve things than to take action.
Right. Ma'am, just wanted to understand from you, is there any specific challenge that you foresee in the effective implementation of this proposed legislation?
Kriti, I think as with any legislation, you know, I mean, I think one, you can make the policy, but then the implementation obviously is where sort
Precisely.
Of the rubber meets the road.
Precisely.
And I think as with anything, I think it is really going to involve a huge set of, it's a very diverse set of stakeholders, and it's, you know, it's got, for the first time, I think we're going to be bringing very, very different groups, some of which are not, you know, we have not even known about a lot of these. So bringing all of the stakeholders and sort of getting the standards, I think it's going to be a very, very long, tedious, very detailed and deliberate exercise. But really, I really can't see why it's a win-win solution as we see it for the system. So much as there will be, there will be a lot of work involved, deliberate, and like I said, deliberate as well as a very detailed action that is required to ensure the implementation. I think even the way we have, come to date for this to happen has been in a very, very systematic fashion over the last few years. 70 plus years, you know, since there has been not a regulator or not a standard setter for these group of people. In the last 5-6 years, or in particular in the last 2-3 years, has been a lot of work. As you already heard Mr. Singhal say, 57, 58, you know, we were hoping we didn't get to 60. I think luckily it came before that. But it's been a lot of thinking on it, and that will continue to happen. But that's about all I envision, is really taking the stakeholders, bringing more discussions happening through across the health system, as in across the whole channel of health providers. And that's what I think we will intend to do as a system.
So when will this proposed law see the light of day? What's the way ahead?
That is up to the parliament, of course. The bill will now go to the parliament. And normally the practice is that such bills are referred to the parliamentary standing committee of the department. So it will go there, and then there will be a wide consultation with all the stakeholders. Now, we ourselves have had lots of discussions with stakeholders, and by and large, you are aware that there was a paramedical council bill in 2007, and there was another NCHRH, National Commission for Human Resources and Health bill in 2012, both of which were passed on to the parliamentary committee, and they did not pass muster. They were withdrawn. So this bill has come after lots of deliberations with many people. As we were saying earlier, it is the 57th draft of this bill, and efforts have been going on since 1994 to come out with a bill of this kind. So this time we have gone to the cabinet, and we'll go to the parliament after lots of consultations. So the first and foremost challenge before us would of course be that the bill has to be passed by the parliament, for which there will be consultations. And we hope, and I in fact would appeal to all the associations in this field of allied health workers, professionals, that they should support this bill before the parliamentary committee. You see, they say that best is the enemy of good. So even if there's some shortcoming, they're not entirely happy with the draft. There always can be some improvements. But even if they're not entirely happy, they should support it, because better late than never. We should do it now instead of waiting for some more years to do it. And once it is passed by the parliament, then of course, as Kavitaji was pointing out, the work before us is humongous. It's not only that we'll have to look at all the people who are there in the country right now, 9 lakh, 10 lakhs of them, see what qualifications they have, standardize and segregate them into those who can be registered, those who cannot be registered. That will be a ticklish and complicated task. Then getting all the states on board, setting up state councils would be a huge task. Some states have their own councils. They would have to be merged and absorbed in the new proposed council. So that will be another very huge exercise. And the third, of course, would be of designing curricula and designing minimum standards which are to be followed by colleges which can impart education. Once we do all that, then looking at specific colleges and granting them recognition, recognizing courses. So the amount of work to be done is huge, it's humongous. And one can only think about that day when it comes, when the parliament passes it, then we'll have to get down, slog and do all these things. Right now we have to wait for the parliament to consider it. And when is it going to be passed is anybody's guess. I can't really say. It's a parliamentary process, you are aware of that. But we hope it will pass muster. We hope it will be supported by all segments which are involved. And very soon we'll have a bill. Ultimately, after 70 years of independence, we'll have a bill in this regard.
Right, absolutely. Coming to my last question, and I'd like to get the inputs from both of you. What would be the impact of this proposed legislation on the overall healthcare delivery system in India? Mr. Singhal?
I believe the quality of healthcare will improve vastly because, as she said, it's a multidisciplinary team which looks at a patient, and the allied health professionals are a very important part of that team. The doctor himself, if you go to a hospital today like AIIMS or RML or Safdarjung, you will find one doctor will be looking at something like 300 patients every day. It's a huge number. He doesn't really have the time. And very often we find that patients are not satisfied because they think the doctor should have devoted more time. It is a fact. But the doctor does not have time. So if we have qualified people working, then both the pillars of Ayushman Bharat would be strengthened. It will be a very, very major, very important change in the way we deliver healthcare in this country.
Ma'am, how will it strengthen the healthcare delivery system in India?
I think I literally almost, I think verbatim, just sort of almost repeat what Ms. Singhal said here, which is, I think it's a paradigm shift in care delivery, you know, from sort of saying we are, you know, only relying on, you know, one or two groups. I think we're opening it out. And at the same time, by having very clear delineated role structures, as well as, you know, outcomes that are defined, I think the overall healthcare system definitely we will see much better, much safer outcomes, much better clinical outcomes, I think, for the patient population which is awaiting. And I think also it opens up, you know, we keep talking about the sector growing. Well, this is really growth in the sector because it opens up education.